We have another fabulous session. I'm Mark Cullen. I'm the Senior Associate Dean for Research here at the school. One of the most fantastic things about the research environment of the school, by way of introduction to the session, is that not only do we have the fabulous Maternal and Child Health Research Institute, but we have, in addition, four other institutes right here within the medical school campus and innumerable centers. And the fabulous aspect of this is that we exchange benefits. And in the next session, you're going to hear from four faculty members working in the child health space who've enjoyed the funding, not from MCHRI directly, but from one of the sister institutions here on campus. So first, without further ado, I want to introduce Rosa Bacchetta, who's an associate professor in the Department of Pediatrics and got her funding from SPARC, one of our great innovator programs. When she's done her talk, for people who want to ask questions, please use the speakers. We are trying to record the session, and if you, however good your voice is, if you do it away from a speaker, we lose you. Thanks. Anyway, Rosa.
Thank you very much, Mark. Okay, good morning, everybody. I'm really honored to be here and have the opportunity to contribute the day after and, you know, give back after a lot of support I have had from CHRI and SPARC. So I'd like to start my talk with pointing out that my research activity is really all the time related and integrated with the activity of the Center for Genetic Immune Diseases, in which a group of dedicated physicians are seeing patients and in connect with a group of scientists, and we constantly interact to provide diagnostic tools that are not normally available in clinical laboratories. And really what the patient that we see are affected mainly with immunodeficiency and autoimmunity, and either, you know, predominance of lack of the ability to fight infection or really autoimmune symptoms because of genetic mutation, monogenic mutation in different genes that impair the function of different cell subsets in our immune system. And so our goal is really to provide, to know better the diseases, in give a diagnosis to who doesn't have a diagnosis yet very often, and provide innovative targeted treatment. So why IPEX? IPEX stands for immune dysregulation polyendocrinopathy, enteropathy, and is an X-linked disease, so it's manifested only in male. And the reason of our interest into this disease is that it has been really the prototype of monogenic autoimmune disease due to FOXP3 mutation. So patients with FOXP3 mutation, in the presence of FOXP3 mutation, the T regulatory cell subset of our body that comes out from the thymus are unable to function properly, and therefore are unable to suppress autoreactive T cells that we have in the body, and therefore these autoreactive T cells throughout life really attack different organs and systems, and especially pancreas, determine type 1 diabetes and gut and skin, but not only that, and liver and kidney and so on. So as we shown in a large cohort of IPEX patients, 96 patients are collected all over the world, the disease nowadays is much more easily diagnosed. I mean, there is more awareness of this disease, and it's amazing to see that really the majority of the patients have the onset very early, so in the first months or within the first year of life. And you can imagine how devastating could be an enteropathy or type 1 diabetes in one in a 1 month old baby. So the challenge of curing this patient is really very consistent, because FOXP3 is a master regulator in T cell immune function, and it is absolutely essential for T regulatory cells, as we said, but it is also very important in T effector cells because it is an intrinsic regulator of the cell cycle, for example. And so this patient typically have lymphoproliferation. So the stable FOXP3 expression is determined uniquely in the T regulatory cells, is determined by demethylation, DNA demethylation of a Treg specific demethylated region, which is called TSDR, and it can be measured in DNA, in really a small drop of blood. And so, studying this already a while ago, we demonstrated that the diagnosis of IPEX can really be facilitated by assessing the amount of epigenetic demethylated region at the TSDR, and this, which is particularly high in IPEX patients as compared to patients with similar symptoms but of different cause. And we have recently extended this measurement to gut record, with the ability of observing that indeed even in IPEX patients at birth, this TSDR the methylation is very, very high. And so, really this could impact the diagnosis in the future of this disease. So current treatment are very limited. So the current treatment are immunosuppression that should be started immediately after diagnosis, and bone marrow transplantation. So both have limited outcome in terms of limited survival of bone marrow transplantation. It's about 70% only of patients, of course, which have available donors. And as you can see, the immunosuppression instead, if it is, lifelong immunosuppression, this study is 25 years old, 25 years follow-up, the disease-free survival is very poor and progressively deteriorating. So our approach and our proposal is a cell gene therapy approach for IPEX syndrome, and in particular we have two different approaches or two different strategies. So one strategy is to convert the CD4 positive T cells, so the whole CD4 compartment, into T regulatory cells by overexpression of a wild type FOXP3 gene under a constitutive promoter. So these CD4 positive T cells of the patient would become always T regulatory cells, a part of them, of course. And then we have a marker gene which can identify and the transduced cells and allow us to separate these cells in vitro and then to re-inject them in the patients and also to track them in vivo. The second approach is a more lifelong approach to cure using CD34 positive HSCs and with CRISPR-Cas9 determine a gene correction of the autologous cells of the patient so that they can give them back and cure the disease. So for the first approach, there is a nice poster if you are interested in more detail, and these are very strong cells, and we have finished the preclinical assessment, and we are building a phase 1 clinical trial to use these cells in IPEX patients. I just want to point out that if we can prove feasibility and safety of these cells in IPEX patients, really this opens to more wide application of these T regulatory cells in multiple diseases, also not monogenic diseases or even graft versus host. But really, as I said before, what we really aim is not a treatment, but the cure of the disease, which we think can only be achieved by acting on the HSCs, intervening on the HSCs with gene editing approach, providing a wild type FOXP3 under endogenous physiological regulation. So this is the gene, and you can see all the different mutations that are scattered through the gene, and therefore, you know, this also is a challenge in terms of gene editing, and what we are building is the possibility to correct the mutation, not a single mutation, but to insert the whole cDNA of a wild-type cDNA, and which you know, could therefore correct the mutation of all the patients to provide this cDNA together with an NGFR, again, marker gene that is useful to sort the cells and track the cells, because the FOXP3 is not expressed in the HSC status. And to do this, to insert the cDNA via CRISPR-Cas9 system and the AAV delivery of the donor in after the regulatory region, so preserving the expression of the promoter and the enhancer. And the preclinical studies that we are doing are foreseeing validation in the CD4 effector cells and T regulatory cells to prove the normal physiological expression of our wild-type gene inserted. And then, of course, we have validation in mouse models. So I just show you a couple of slides to see the main results that we obtain. So with using this construct that we have up to now, we obtain restoration of FOXP3 protein expression, although you can see that is not a full restoration, that is a partial restoration, which is effective at suppression, although again it is within the normal level, but still in the lower part of the normal level. So there is space for improvement. There are several reasons why this could have happened, and we are studying, including, you know, changing construct, and we are studying this in more detail. And of course, then we inject this, we make the correction of the edited cells, and we inject the human cells into intrahepatically into NSG mice or immunodeficient mice, and we could observe persistence of the edited cells in vivo in these mice up to the end of the experiment, week 12 or 16, and also differentiation in T cells in both non-edited and edited cells, however, in edited cells, the efficiency and the survival was less pronounced, suggesting that, you know, I mean, installing the doubt that maybe really is not, these cells do not have an advantage and we should sort them before treating patients. And we are now also using a different model, which is more robust in determining the T regulatory cell development in these humanized mice. So the take-home message of these studies is that, yes, genome editing for FOXP3 is under development and with promising results on feasibility of the approach. And definitely when we want to insert and re-establish FOXP3 expression, we need to be very careful at the level of HSPCs and consider a tight restoration of the expression. And this CD4LV FOXP3 converted T cells, we hope that they will be soon available in the clinic for these patients and other patients. And really, this could lay the foundation for treating similar diseases with a different cause. So I like to really thank all the people in the lab, especially Yohei Sato and Marianne Goodwin, postdoc in the group, and the PhD Esmond, all the support by Spark and CHRI, and also anonymous donors, and the continuous interaction with the lab of Roncarolo and the people in her group. And I really want to a special thank to the BAS Center team and the Cell Transplantation Unit, since without each of those physicians, really could not have been possible to treat recently these two IPEX patients in the unit, which are the first one that were treated with transplant at Stanford. And thank you for your attention.
You inserted this wild type of this FOXP3 in this endogenous FOXP3 locus. So did you compare this expression level exactly the same with the wild type?
Yeah, so we are comparing it, and it seems the same. Well, I showed that it's partially restoration, so depending in the Treg cells is a little bit lower than normal, and in the T effector cells is actually the same. So there is a normal regulation, but the expression may be a little lower with the construct we are using. So one thing I didn't say is that our construct is only providing the full length of FOXP3 and not the isoform 2. So that may be one of the reasons.
Great. Thank you. Anyway, thank you. Thank you very much.